I'm Tiina, and I work in Sexpo Foundation as a communications manager. And I do also some therapy and counseling, and I train future sexual counselors. And then I love to work with minority groups. I have minority groups, people who live in marginal, who come to meet me to my office to have counseling and therapy. So men who have been circumcised are one group. My background is in theology. My first degree is from theology, and after that I was teaching a few years. With those kids, youngsters, I realized that sex and sexuality are a huge thing in our life, and I really want to know more. So I started to learn sexology, and I came familiar with Sexpo. And there has always been powerful thinking about human rights, which include sexual rights and children's rights. And this male circumcision was one topic there. And now we have a project intact in Sexpo, and I really feel that my heart is in that project too. We felt via our patients and our, those who we work with, that this is something for years ago already, this is something that need to be noticed, and this is something we need to like to raise to public awareness. The thing troubled me maybe when I was starting to learn more about religions and philosophy and human rights, then I noticed that now there is something that doesn't match. Yeah, and I felt that I'm not comfortable with this. Now there are more people who know that there is something that needs to be done, and there has been these awful cases that we have come to knowledge. But I still think that it's something we don't really take seriously enough, because now when we had this symposium in Helsinki, I think that people now know that there are really men who suffer, who have been harmed, and it's not just stories, it's not just lines in a newspaper. And I think that that moves, it moved me, and it was really emotional, and I had many feelings. And it really gave me strength and wisdom to be together and see that we are one in this. And in Sexpo we really try to push this, like we write to newspapers and we give if they ask our consultation, we give that. And we have doors open if men wants to come to us and tell their story, or mothers want to come to us, or whoever wants to come, we are there for them. It's really important to me to keep in mind that every person is unique and every person has a unique story. And every time that person comes to me, it might be the first time he or she talks about her situation and the life she or he has had till now. And I truly hope that every encounter will give to my patient, or if you want to say, use some other word, but we can use patient here, comes to me and says that this has been in my heart for many years, and I want to give hope and comfort and also empower, in this case, men. And also to give knowledge and like to say that you are a brave man when you have come here. And there is so much that it has not been possible to say before. And of course, I feel that it's something I really have to respect. I want to respect that someone is ready to talk and ready to share. And sometimes happens that the trauma in him comes alive again, and we have to be prepared for that also. But I truly, truly believe that in dialogue, something new is entering, and it gives hope to both of us. And one of the most important things is that when man comes to me and says that he has been harmed, I have to know that I have to keep in mind that that man has been forced to something he didn't choose. He wasn't able to choose. He wasn't able to say that no. And then I must not force him to say or do anything he doesn't want to. So it's always the man who says, and then I react, and then I ask, but I never offend or be too, how do I say, too, only want to know because I want to know, I want to have the information, I'm too curious. But it's always because that man wants to come to my office, wants to meet me. So I need to respect that, and I truly do, yes. One really important thing is that I need to say to the man who comes to me that you have a right to your feelings. I believe you. And what you tell to me has been with you so long time usually. And I believe that it's really hard to start the process and give words and make it all alive again. And yes, bodily violation and all the harm that has been done, there are many similarities, for example, to rape. Yes. Men come to me, or women come to me, and tell what they have thought, what they have felt, and about their life history and their stories. It always puts me, I would say, to a small place, that I say that I need to have big ears and only few words to listen and respect. We felt that boys are, how do you say it in English, like there is no law to them, there is no rights to them in this specific matter. Girls, we know already that circumcision should not be done, that it's wrong, it's stated in our law, but the boys are like outlaw, I'd say, and I don't know if that's the correct term you can use. And we felt that in Finland we have really much in common with other Nordic countries, and people, men and women, they have the same rights, but in this matter they don't. And that is why we wanted this project, and we were lucky enough to have it, the funding for that. And it really has made me angry, and sometimes very frustrated, because big boat turns slowly, and there are so many children who needs our reaction right now and needs our action and our intervention. But I also understand that this is been going on for so long that it's time taking, and we need to be patient. And our INDAC project has been going on now for 16 months, and I believe that there have been many breakthroughs already. And men are contacting us, and media is, and teachers, and lawyers, and doctors. And I feel that, I know that we are right. We respect human rights sexual rights, children's rights, and we want to save those children, and we want to make them feel better. We want to care about their well-being, and I'm so thankful and happy that I can work in this project, also to work with all those people I have encountered, and I believe that our project has impact already, and it will have, and we are going to be even more powerful and more like, how would I put it? I know that there are going to be more and more people who are going to think like us and believe that those rights belong to all, not just to some group, and the public awareness is going to come, and now it's already like about 80% of Finnish population thinks that male circumcision should be banned, and if boys want to decide themselves, it should be about 18. They should be like aged enough to say for themselves, but we need to protect those children, and we need to give information, we need to be brave, and I believe that we are, and we need to speak out and remember that we are never working alone. There are so many of us who are working all over the world, and that really gives me hope and comfort. Yeah, and always that when I feel that there's many things against, I remind myself that there has been many, many obstacles we have already won, and there are going to be many more. If there's a little boy, his parents' religious rights are parents' religious rights, but the boy's religious rights are his own. And I believe that never, ever some other person can do harm to child and say that this is my religious right. That's appalling and awful to me. And I always say that your right is to protect. Your right is to nurse, to give love and comfort, and to really take care of the child. And if someone says that this is something we have been doing for long, so maybe you should think, was the situation different when that tradition started? Because it was. And now many, many religious groups have decided not to go along with the circumcision anymore. And I believe that the change comes from inside the group. And we need to be brave enough to give the information and give support. But always I say that when there is a religious right, it never is powerful than one's right to bodily integrity and to be safe. So that is something that is very clear to me, and I think it's something I cannot understand why any parent would like to harm a child. I don't like to compare sexes or genders. I don't like to say that someone else's illness or sickness is bigger or smaller. I always say that if there's harm, there is something that needs to be think through again. And something bad has happened if child has been hurted. And if they say that what happens to girls is much worse, I think also that it's not true. In some cases it might be, but there are so many cases among boys and girls that, and I really don't like the idea that we need to count how many girls have died and how many boys have died or been hurted. So I truly think that it's not an important question or well, strong argument enough. Do not hurt a child. Yeah.
Pretty simple.
Yeah, it is simple.
Yeah.
I feel blessed that men come to me and tell their story. I feel that, as I said, I'm in a small place then, and I feel it in my heart that there is a connection. That when people seek comfort, help, and wisdom, we can share it. And I believe that we can change the world. Yes.